Miranda presents this unabridged recording of
The Taste for Love, written by Marita Conlon-McKenna, read by Emma Dean Vernal. Chapter 1. Alice Kinsella checked the oven. The rich aroma of spices and apricots from the slowly cooking lamb tagine was filling the kitchen. The table was set, the white wine was chilling in the fridge, and the red wine was on the counter. Everything looked perfect, and she hurried upstairs as she had only half an hour to get ready and change into something a bit more stylish before her guests arrived. It was a Saturday night in November, and it seemed strange hosting a dinner party on her own, but she just had to get used to it. She was fed up of Saturday after Saturday sitting in watching DVDs and game shows on TV and just longed for a bit of decent adult company, everyone sitting around her table with nice food and a few decent bottles of wine. She had always enjoyed having friends around at the weekend or eating out at one of Dublin's many restaurants, and it was one of the things she missed most now that Liam was gone. It was almost a year and a half since their marriage breakup, and she was still trying to get used to the loneliness of it and adjust to life without Liam. At first, friends and family had been great, remembering to include her and asking her to lots of things and nights out, but she had noticed over the past few months that the number of dinner and party invitations had dwindled. It was bad enough losing her husband, her marriage, and her financial security, but losing people she had considered friends was probably the thing that hurt the most. As she pulled her pale grey shift dress on over her black tights and slipped into black suede shoes, she tried to push all negative thoughts of her ex-husband from her mind and concentrate on the night ahead. She was going to enjoy herself and have a bit of fun with or without Liam. "Hey, Mum, is there anything you want me to do?" offered her 22-year-old daughter Jenny, who was home for a few days from Galway, where she was at university. "Will you check I put fresh towels in the downstairs bathroom, please?" Alice glanced at her makeup, understated yet enough to make an impact. Her eyes looked different, with a hint of eyeliner, the smoky grey and beige shadow that Jenny had suggested she try, and the new mascara she had treated herself to. Her light brown hair, longer and recently lightly highlighted, feathered around her face. She added a warm peach-coloured lipstick and topped it off with a little gloss before dabbing on some of her favourite perfume. She was looking a lot better than she had done this time last year, when it had felt like her world had fallen apart, and she had been literally on the floor with anger and rage at the injustice and unfairness of it all. Liam, moving out of their Monkston home and in with Elaine Power, the 38-year-old marriage wrecker he now called his new partner. He and Elaine had scarcely known each other, and yet her husband of nearly 30 years had walked away from his marriage to Alice with barely a backward glance. Their eldest son, Connor, still wasn't speaking to him, and Sean, their 20-year-old, tried to avoid his father. Poor Jenny, their only daughter, did her best to remain neutral. "I've put one of those fancy American towels downstairs." Jenny smiled as she came back into the room and sat down on the bed. "Wow, Mum, you look great. That dress is so good on you. You've lost weight." "Do you think so?" Alice ran her hands over her firmer hips and flatter tummy. "Would you notice?" Alice had to admit that the only good thing to come out of the most stressful time in her life was that she had, for the first time in years, without going on the Atkins or Weight Watchers diets, dropped 10 kilos in weight. She felt the better for it. She was taking far more exercise and was eating less, as she was no longer cooking the kind of meals that Liam enjoyed. A fridge full of red meat and pork and sausages had been replaced by one containing healthy chicken and fish and vegetables. "Everyone will notice," teased her daughter. It was so good to have Jenny in the house, even if it was only for a few days. She would be heading off on the train back to college on Wednesday evening, and Alice would really miss her. Sean was a good kid, but he was rarely around and seemed always to be busy in college doing something or other. Alice suspected he was still in denial about their situation and was trying to avoid it and home as much as possible. Alice jumped as the doorbell went.
"Will I let them in?" offered Jenny.
"Thanks, love. I'll be down in a minute. I think it's probably Joy." Alice looked at her neck, deciding to remove the classic pearls that Liam had given her 10 years ago and put them away in their box. Instead, she took out the silver John Rocha piece that Connor and his girlfriend Lisa had given her last Christmas and put it on. "Better," she said. "Much better." Joy greeted her with a huge hug. Her old school friend was always the first at everything and had already made herself at home in the kitchen. She was clutching a glass of red wine while interrogating her goddaughter Jenny about her love life in Galway.
"Mum, make her stop," begged Jenny, mortified.
"You're living away from home with no mamma or dadda around," teased Joy. "I can only imagine what Alice and I would have got up to in our day. There's bound to be some lovely Galway man around."
"Well, if there is, and I'm not saying there is, you and Mum are the last two I tell."
Alice noticed Joy was wearing her regulation black, this time a skirt with a bolero-type wrap over top, and had made huge efforts with her unruly blonde hair. She was wearing it pinned up neatly. 10 minutes later, Sally and Hugh Ryan had appeared, Hugh carrying 3 bottles of expensive French wine into the kitchen and putting them on the kitchen island.
"Some very good wine to go with some very good food, judging by the aroma tempting my taste buds."
"Thanks, Hugh." They were her dearest friends, and he and Sally had rallied around when Liam had gone off with the witch Elaine, leaving Alice virtually penniless. Sally had been a rock over the past year, even listening to her midnight tirades about Liam and his hussy, while Hugh, practical as ever, had managed to get her a temporary job in the accountancy firm where he was one of the partners. In the 25 years that Hugh had been coming to their house, he had never arrived without bringing a highly recommended wine that added to the occasion. He was a real wine buff, and Liam and he used to spend ages talking about various vintages. She was glad that tonight, despite Liam's absence, he had kept up the tradition.
"And I've got some photos of little Ava, our 10-year-old granddaughter, to show you," added Sally proudly.
Alice was so pleased for them, having their first grandchild. It was such a milestone.
"Champagne to celebrate," she laughed as she took the Bollinger from the fridge, Hugh gallantly doing the honours and opening the bottle for her.
To little Ava, they toasted as Nina Brennan and her husband David joined them too.
"I'll stick with the red wine," insisted Joy. "Champagne just goes straight to my head."
Alice could certainly vouch for that. They moved to the sitting room, the fire blazing in the grate, as Alice's neighbours, the Cassidys, appeared. Molly Cassidy had been a great friend to Alice over the years, and even though she and her husband Jack were a good bit older than Alice, they were wonderful company. Jack, retired from his career in the Garda, still seemed to know everything that was going on in the country. The last to arrive were Alice's brother Tim, his wife Patsy, and their daughter Erin, who was 6 months younger than Jenny. An only child, Erin had spent a vast amount of her childhood in the Kinsella's house, and she and Jenny were great friends as well as being cousins. Jenny went to get more champagne glasses as everyone relaxed and chatted easily.
This is such a treat, declared Molly. Jack is always delighted when Alice invites us over, as she's the best cook we know. Good to have a decent meal compared to that awful stuff we ate on holiday, Jack said. Where were you? Asked Joy.
We got back from Egypt on Tuesday, explained Molly. We went on a cruise on the Nile, visited Cairo and the museum, and of course the pyramids. We stayed in some wonderful places.
Cost us an arm and a leg, but it still didn't stop us getting tummy trouble, Jack groaned. Followed all the precautions, but it made no difference.
Well, at least you're back on your home turf now, consoled Joy.
Alice slipped back into the kitchen. Everything was going perfectly. She checked the lamb. It tasted rich and warm, perfect for a chilly night. She would serve it with couscous and a creamy mash that she knew Jack and her brother Tim were very partial to. The green beans were perfect, and there was the obligatory salad, as she knew Erin and Jenny were big into greens. She popped her starter of goat's cheese into the top oven to warm. Once everyone was seated, she would cover it with some crumbs and herbs and give it a quick toasting before serving it on a bed of rocket, accompanied by the cooked beetroot that went so perfectly with it. Lighting a few candles, she called everyone to the table. Sitting around, chatting as everyone ate and laughed and told stories, Alice relaxed. David and Tim were on second helpings of the lamb, and Jack had gotten through a mound of creamy mash. The wine was flowing, and Hugh was great at making sure that new bottles were opened as needed. They were all such good friends, and she didn't know how she would have survived the past 18 months without them. They had bent over backwards to support her and encourage her to stand on her own two feet again. Each person at the table, in their own way, had listened and advised and encouraged her.
Alice, how do you do it? Cook such delicious food and still manage to lose weight.
Sally sighed. With her curvy figure, she was constantly trying diets and gyms and weight loss clubs.
Heartbreak, Sally, but you well know I wouldn't recommend it.
I put on almost 2 stone after Malcolm and I split, admitted Joy. I was so sad, and I guess I was comfort eating. It was only when I realised that poor Beth was worried about me that I managed to pull myself together and decided that there had to be life after Malcolm. It was what both Beth and I deserved. I realised that the only person who could make me happy with my life was me.
And you've been enjoying yourself ever since, teased Jenny.
Of course, said Joy, raising her glass. That's what it's all about.
Alice smiled. Joy had refused to let her sit home and mope after the breakup and had dragged her to dinners and lunches, walks, theatres and gallery openings, weekends in Barcelona and Prague, as well as a few trips to Joy's holiday cottage down in Wexford. Alice would be lost without her best friend, and they always seemed to have fun together. The talk at the table turned to politics, and Jack and Tim nearly came to blows about the state of the economy and what should be done to solve it, while Hugh, the accountant, tried to calm things. At her end of the table, Molly told them she and Jack were planning to visit China the next year to see Beijing and Hong Kong and walk the Great Wall.
You two are such intrepid travellers, you put us all to shame, remarked Nina Brennan enviously.
Well, as Jack says, it beats sitting around waiting for the two of us to get old.
Jenny helped Alice serve the warm apple and almond tart with vanilla ice cream and whipped cream and made coffee for everyone. Alice was relieved that everything had gone so well.
Alice, that lamb had such a flavour. How do you do it? Asked Sally.
The secret is in marinating it in lots of spices overnight and then slow cooking it, Alice explained.
And you must give me the recipe for this, begged her sister-in-law Patsy,
as she finished the last crumb of the light almond tart. "I'll email it to you," Alice offered. "I'm always trying out Alice's recipes, but somehow, when I make them at home, they never seem quite as good," Patsy joked. "That's because she's a natural cook," Jack beamed. "Molly has got green fingers.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.